It's time to get in touch. In Touch is a public affairs show dedicated to improving the lives of Susquehanna Valley residents. I'm Freddi Hammer, news director at Backyard Broadcasting. Breast cancer detection and treatment have made major strides over the last decade or so. Funding of breast cancer research, one of those reasons the progress is made. October being Breast Cancer Awareness Month, we're able to talk today with Dr. Rebecca Jordan from Geisinger Medical Center. Good morning, Dr. Jordan.
Good morning.
Tell me your position at Geisinger Medical Center. You're a breast cancer surgeon.
Yes, ma'am. I am a breast surgical oncologist here at Geisinger Wyoming Valley.
Well, thank you for joining me today and sharing your expertise about some of the things that I'd love to just ask questions about, because I have misunderstandings, I'm sure, and maybe some of our listeners do too. My question is it safe to say when detected early, breast cancer is a much less of a killer than it used to be?
Absolutely. I think the best advances that we've had is this early detection, proficient screening with mammograms starting at an earlier age, at age 40, is what we typically recommend. And when breast cancers are found early, we know that the overall prognosis and survival is much better. And then sometimes that affects the treatment options as well, and you may not require as much treatment if found early.
I think the impression that I've always had, you kind of have your grandmother's breast cancer thoughts, maybe, that the treatment was bad, the invasive and painful, and that's not necessarily the case anymore.
Right, that's a good point. You know, actually, we have a lot of patients who come in who have kind of this memory of their family members and what they went through, you know, 20, 30 years ago. And it's important to remember that while the screening has improved, so has the treatment options. Maybe what they went through is not necessarily what's recommended today. So it's important to discuss those concerns with your provider, but you know that there's lots of options now. And again, finding things early opens you up to a lot more options for less invasive treatments.
Would you say that there's more of a diagnosis in the fall now that Breast Cancer Awareness Month being October, everybody starts, oh yes, I got to get my mammogram. So I'm just sort of thinking maybe that's the case.
I do think sometimes, you know, it's a good reminder, and that's why we continue to push, you know, Breast Cancer Awareness Month, because, you know, life catches up to you, and especially with COVID, a lot of women, you know, either weren't able to get in for their screening mammograms because of scheduling issues or issues with their own family. And so I think this time of year, it's a good reminder in case you haven't done it yet this year. Oh, yes, I need to go get that done this year.
Some people say they go on their birthday, or every year, if a teacher I know always goes over Christmas break, they schedule it and it's a regular thing.
Yeah, that's a great idea, to just give yourself a little reminder and, you know, to stay current with your primary care physician as well, so that they can keep you up to date on, you know, breast cancer screening, but also other screenings as well.
When a person then is diagnosed with breast cancer or concerns, or they have an image where they need to go back for a second time, that fear, hopefully we're going to be able to dissipate that, because we want to say that there's some things now that are not so invasive, like we said. So what's the first thing that people do when they're diagnosed with breast cancer? What's the first task?
Right. Well, you know, that feeling that you have when you are told that you have a cancer is, you know, so strong and can be devastating. But it's important to remember that you have a team here to help you get through this, and that's why we're here. So the first thing to do, usually when you are diagnosed with a breast cancer, someone from the team, often a radiologist, is going to contact you and let you know this is what the biopsy showed. And then they're going to put you in contact with the breast team, and they're going to get you into either a breast surgeon or a medical oncologist, someone from the team, to start talking about a plan. I think, you know, most people come into the clinic with very little information, and having little information is the scariest part, I think. Once they come in and we talk about the options, we talk about the plan, I think people feel better, and you can see that, you know, this is going to be something that we have to go through together for a few months, but you can hopefully see the light at the end of the tunnel after the treatment is over to get you, you know, past this cancer diagnosis, back to your life.
There's different kinds of surgeries that may come up. I mean, a question always someone asks is it operable? Can they take it out? Is that the first question that someone says, is a surgery option? There's a couple different things people can do.
Yes, exactly. And again, it comes back to early detection. So early detection has helped us find so many more cancers at an early stage that we typically can't feel them on exam. We can't see them with our naked eye. So that opens up the opportunity for what's called breast conservation, or if you've heard more commonly, a lumpectomy. And a lot of patients nowadays are candidates for that because of early detection. The alternative to that is a mastectomy, where we remove most of the breast tissue, and that can be done with or without reconstruction. And typically, you know, I discuss both options with the patient as long as they're safe from a cancer standpoint. And it's a very personal choice, the type of surgery you have. But again, having early detection, finding something when it's small, opens up the opportunities to have multiple options.
As an oncologist, would you be speaking with a patient that was doing a preemptive mastectomy, someone who may have breast cancer in their family and wants to remove their breast to just take the option away?
Yes, I do see patients for that. So typically, we see patients with a genetic mutation of some sort that may put them at an increased risk for developing cancer in their lifetime. Mm-hmm. You know, it's important to remember that most breast cancers just happen. You know, up to 80% of breast cancers happen without a family history or without a genetic component. But we do have patients who are found to have a genetic component that puts them at an increased risk, and they may benefit from what we call a prophylactic mastectomy, or removing the breast to try to avoid a future cancer diagnosis. That's, you know, a small subset of patients that would qualify for that, but it's certainly something that we discuss.
Also, medication has changed quite a bit. So like we were talking about earlier, you may not get as sick as your family member did 30 years ago. Now there's very targeted chemotherapies and different options for people. That's something that you prescribe.
Absolutely. So typically the medication side is managed by the medical oncologist. You know, we all work together as a team, the surgeon, medical oncologist, radiation oncologist, to hit, you know, this cancer from multiple angles. Mm-hmm. But yes, the chemotherapy and targeted therapies have changed significantly in the last several years. And there's also, you know, new treatments and kind of preemptive strategies to avoid some of those classic side effects like hair loss and nerve damage and things like that that can be discussed even prior to starting the medication.
It's so heartening to see people surviving. We have so many survivors that are able to say, yes, we got through this, and we're so grateful for the medicine and the work that you and your team can do to make that happen.
Yes, absolutely. I mean, that's what we want to see is the survivorship, you know, continuing to improve. I think, again, our best tool for that is screening and early detection. And I think, you know, it does cause a lot of anxiety for women, understandably so, but knowing that finding something early is really advantageous in comparison to waiting.
One question just on the insurance side of things. Can you speak to the fact that some insurances are different with the treatments of cancer and then follow up later? I mean, is there something that as a patient we need to make sure that we're covering for ourselves if this is in our future?
I am no expert on insurance, but typically most insurances will cover preventative screenings and preventative visits. Mm-hmm. So usually that includes, you know, a yearly well visit to your primary care doctor. For a woman over 40, that should include a mammogram, as well as any gynecologic screening that you need and any future colon cancer screening that's recommended. So I would make sure that, you know, you want to have a plan that covers those preventative screenings, or at least helps out with that. You know, regarding coverage once you're diagnosed with breast cancer, some people, you know, have life changes and cancer doesn't care about that. Mm-hmm. So we have resources to help those patients that need it if maybe their insurance coverage is not robust enough, or maybe they're in between coverage. You know, we have resources, and that we have social workers and other members of the team who help us with anything like that that may arise.
So now we're in survivorship and people are in remission and they're not seeing any evidence of cancers as you continue to treat them. I feel like they would see you in a rotating basis every year.
Right. It's pretty individualized based on the type of cancer that they have and the overall stage. But typically we will follow patients every 6 months after their surgery and other treatments. And then you'll typically resume imaging, if that's appropriate, about a year after your surgery and completion of your other treatments. And we keep a close eye on things for usually 3 to 5 years. And then we kind of consider, have you kind of graduated to the next step in survivorship? But again, everyone on the team is keeping a close eye on things.
Well, now as you have a family member who may be in that survivorship mode, what are the things that they need to maybe consider? You think, she's a survivor. She's great now. But there still may be some health problems that linger for some folks afterwards from what I'm reading.
Right. So, and that's all very dependent on the type of treatment that they received. So, again, we know that women do best from breast cancer when they get a multimodal approach, typically with some combination of surgery, medications, and radiation. And all of those things can have certain side effects. The most important thing is to communicate with your providers to make sure that they're aware if you're having some side effects, you know, such as pain or scarring from your surgery, or if you're having some muscle aches or menopausal type symptoms from your medications, or some, you know, skin effects from your radiation. If you communicate that with the providers, then we have ways to either alleviate those issues or to help prevent them from getting worse.
Well, I think it's wonderful that we're in such an advanced stage of medicine right now, where we can really target these different cancers and eradicate them. What's the best advice that you can give for us as people who are, you know, what's our best bet to avoid cancer altogether? Can you even say that?
Well, you know, as we all probably know, breast cancer is one of the most common cancers in the world. We know 1 in 8 women will be diagnosed within their lifetime with breast cancer. So there are things that you can do to try to set yourself up for a healthy lifestyle in general. You know, maintaining a healthy weight, healthy diet, you know, minimizing alcohol consumption, participating in weekly exercise. Things that are good for your body in general are good for the breast. Again, up to 80% of breast cancers that happen are not from a genetic source. And so sometimes you can do all the right things and you still may end up with a diagnosis of breast cancer. But the other key part of that, again, is the screening mammograms or other screening imaging if you're thought to be at higher risk, and finding things early.
Well, I've been involved in several of the walks around different cities, and I'm feeling like the research is just robust because of all the fundraising. We're going to keep doing that. Is that what can the funds go for in the future? We're getting better and better at eradicating cancer altogether.
Absolutely. I mean, there's still so much about cancer in general, and especially breast cancer, that we don't know. You know, we're learning new things every day. There's just so much new information coming out from studies being performed on, you know, whether it is looking at surgery or medications, chemotherapy, or, you know, do we need to do all of this for this type of cancer versus, you know, can we do less and people have the same outcomes? So the walks and everything are great for both just public realization, but also to help raise money for those ongoing studies and that research to hopefully eventually eradicate it completely. But until then, to have the best treatment options possible with the least side effects and kind of least impact on a woman's life.
One just personal question for you, Dr. Jordan. I wondered what your personal involvement with being a breast surgeon and oncologist, has that pushed you into that career for a certain reason, or is it just the interest you've had since your education?
So, I mean, I'm open with my patients of sharing. You know, I do have family history of breast cancer, and I have watched family members go through treatments, and I think that is what kind of pushed me into this field. And I think it helps me with my patients because I understand what it feels like when your family member tells you that they've been diagnosed with cancer and that kind of hit in your stomach you immediately feel. And then I also understand what it looks like at the end of the tunnel and after all of the treatments. And I hope that, you know, having that perspective helps me be a better physician for them, a better surgeon, more understanding to what they're going through.
Dr. Jordan, do you have a family?
I do. Married and have a young son.
Well, wonderful. I'm grateful for you, a surgical oncologist at Geisinger Medical Center. You're a breast surgeon.
My technical title would be a breast surgical oncologist. Yes, so I specialize primarily in breast surgery, breast treatment for both benign and malignant disease.
Well, Dr. Rebecca Jordan, Geisinger Medical Center, thank you for joining us today and informing us so much more about just the process of when you are diagnosed with breast cancer, how you can become a survivor. And we're grateful for all your information. And thanks for being with us today on In Touch.
Absolutely. Thank you for having me.
In Touch is locally produced in our studios at 1685 Four Mile Drive in Williamsport. To get in touch with us regarding questions, comments, or topic ideas, call weekdays between 8 and 5, 570-323-8200. You can also write to us at 1685 Four Mile Drive, Williamsport, PA, 17701, attention Freddi Hammer, or email me at fhammer@backyardbroadcasting.com. For archived programs of our In Touch series, you can download and subscribe to our new Backyard Podcasting feature through a link on any Backyard Broadcasting website or obtained where podcasts are available. You can also subscribe to our YouTube channel, Backyard Broadcasting. The programming discussed here on In Touch does not necessarily reflect the feelings or opinions of the management or staff. Thanks for listening to In Touch, a production of Backyard Broadcasting.